We stop for lunch just outside the park at a place called Glitter Gulch, which is the name that the locals like to call it because of all the gift shops that cater to the tourists, although the place does not officially have a name. After lunch, we head to the park entrance for the Discover Denali program. Denali National Park is Alaska's most popular destination. The park itself is slightly larger than the entire state of Massachusetts. The Discover Denali program is designed as an introduction to the subarctic and Denali National Park. It starts with a film followed by a naturalistic presentation that describes the natural and cultural history of the subarctic ecosystem in and around the park. After the presentation, we go on a guided walk on a park trail to learn more about the local flora, fauna, and geological formations in the park. Denali National Park was established in 1917, primarily to protect Dall sheep, which were being hunted almost to the brink of extinction after the Yukon-Klondike gold rush. The original park was about 1 million acres. Then in 1980, another 5 million acres were added, so that today it is a little over 6 million acres. The Arctic Circle is the latitude in which, on the longest day of the year, the sun does not go below the horizon. Denali is about 250 miles south of the Arctic Circle. On the longest day of the year, there is 21 and a half hours of direct sunlight. Even though the sun does go below the horizon for 2.5 hours at night, it is still considered daylight because the sun only goes about 6 degrees below the horizon. Thus, everything is in photosynthesis overdrive. Every animal and every bird is eating around the clock because there are only 14 weeks of summer to make it or break it in preparation for winter.
Layers of the scales off these little spruce cones. And what's going on here are, we only have two types of tree squirrels here. We've got the little red squirrel and the northern flying squirrel. And the little red tree squirrel will clip these cones once they get mature, and the seed bearing cones, the female cones, are on the top of these spruce trees, and you can look up and see them up there. This year's crop hasn't fully formed yet, but when they get more robust, the tree squirrel will clip them off the top of the tree. They fall to the ground, and then they cache them down in these little holes, like you can see right here. And in the wintertime, when our temperatures get cold, like below minus 20, these tree squirrels come down out of the trees and roost in the snow. Everything does. Ptarmigan, snowshoe hare, even little red poles, a little finch that we have. They're all trying to take advantage of that insulation of the snow. And they just sit right here on top of their little cone cache and eat these seeds. And one little scale at a time, they peel off to get down to the seed that's inside. And to have a cache like this probably took literally hundreds of years. I mean, it's probably about a 150-year-old cone cache here, because that's about how old these trees are. And evidently, each little family of squirrels will avidly protect about a quarter acre around its cone cache. So this family has been here for many, many millennia that have had built up this cone cache like this. But they're also referred to as the Johnny Appleseed of the forest, because if a fire were to come through here and wipe out all the trees, we've already got a good supply of these cones that are already buried down in the soil, and those warm soils by the fire will allow that cone to, with the seeds in the cone, to regenerate the next generation of spruce trees. So these little tree squirrels very much benefit this ecosystem.
There are only 37 species of mammals in Denali, compared to about 100 for Yellowstone National Park. There are only 5 large mammals that can survive Denali on a year-round basis: moose, caribou, grizzly bears, wolves, and Dall sheep, which are the only white mountain sheep in the world. The long winters make it difficult for mammals to survive in Denali. On the winter solstice, the sun will only rise to about 11 degrees above the horizon. However, because of all the mountains and surrounding hills that intercept the low-angle light, much of the park never sees direct sunlight. For those animals that cannot migrate out or hibernate through winter, they have to either cache their food supply, like the ground squirrel, or pack on the weight. The bull moose can gain 400 pounds in the summer and weigh as much as 1,600 pounds. They live off their fat during the winter. These animals are timed to have their babies born right at the start of the summer green-up so that they can take advantage of the short food supply and fatten up all summer long. Moose calves are about 15 to 20 pounds when born. By October, they weigh up to 500 pounds. Brown bears, grizzly bears, and Kodiak bears are all the same species. However, brown bears on the coast and Kodiak bears on Kodiak Island have an easier time surviving eating a high-protein diet of salmon all summer. The grizzly bears in Denali do not have access to salmon. Most of the rivers are glacier-fed rivers with so much sediment that fish can't survive. They live off of a high-carbohydrate diet of berries during the summer. Thus, while the brown bears and Kodiak bears along the coast can weigh as much as 1,000 to 1,600 pounds, the grizzly bears in the interior of Alaska can weigh as little as 300 pounds. About 80% of interior Alaska is underlined by permafrost. Permafrost is permanently frozen soil that may or may not have an ice component. Rock and dirt is locked up in a frozen state with an active layer above that thaws in the summertime. The active layer could be a thin veneer of only 2 inches, or it could be 20 feet thick. Once you get down to the permafrost, it is thousands of feet thick. Along the trail, we come to Hines Creek. Most of the rivers and creeks in this area are fed by melting snow from the glaciers. The sediment in the water from the glaciers causes the oxygen level of the water to be very low, making it difficult for fish to survive. Thus, they usually have no fish in them.
There used to be a lot of people that lived around here during those gold rush days, and then when the construction workers came for the railroad, the Park Service built their headquarters down here to keep a little law on the land. And you can find all sorts of stuff like this little hidden, if you see this wooden wash tub. What was interesting, there used to be an old log cabin up here, and it had, you know, the log cabins were built out of spruce, and they usually had sphagnum moss for chinking, for insulation. There's some folks that are walking by. And they'd have sphagnum moss on the roof, you know, it'd be a sod roof. And then what they would use as a refrigerator or a freezer is they would always dig down into the permafrost. And the permafrost here, you'd have to dig down probably a good 5-6 feet, maybe even more. So they'd put their, you know, the insulated boxes down right on top of the permafrost and cover it up with tundra. But on the north side of every little cabin, there would be this screened-in box that you could reach out into and keep the food that you wanted kept cool. On the north side, it's on the shaded side, and it's screened in so squirrels and stuff don't get into it. And when you turn into McKinley Village today, when you go back to where you're staying, there's this little, it looks like a miniature log cabin up on stilts. And what that is called a food cache. And you would keep food up there that you wanted to keep away from grizzly bears and a host of other pests. So there were different ways to take care of your food. And interestingly enough, the Denali area was never hooked up to the grid. We didn't have electricity here until 14 years ago. So nobody had electricity. And all of us are used to hauling water and heating with, you know, firewood and having propane lights and propane refrigerators. And if you, you know, you could generate your own electricity if you had a little generator. But it wasn't that long ago that everybody was keeping their food, you know, in boxes down on the permafrost and hauling water from springs and using, you know, a lot of wood for heat.
After our introduction to Denali National Park, we saw a moose alongside the road on our way to the hotel.
Off to the left, right at the tree line there.
Oh, there he is.
Everybody's taking pictures. Where is he?
He's right at the tree line. His head's feeding on some of the trees there.
Oh my goodness!
Zoom that camera.
For the next two nights, we are staying at the McKinley Village Lodge, located 7 miles south of the park entrance. This 188-room lodge is located along the banks of the Nenana River. Spread out over 20 acres, there are hiking trails with spectacular views.
Thank you.
I wonder where the other baby is. Do you think that one's a baby? You think that?
Bucket is falling asleep.